Hey guys, welcome to the Sunday Dev Hangout. My apologies for the earlier mic problems. If you don't follow us already, please follow us on Twitch at twitch.tv/gamesfoundry. Alternatively, you can follow us on Twitter, which is at gamesfoundry, or you can visit our YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/gamesfoundry. As usual, in the Hangout today, we'll be giving away a Steam key for Folktale. You just have to be watching the stream to be able to enter that. More information will follow when the time comes. In terms of today's Hangout, what we're going to do is we're going to jump into a swamp map that I've been working on in the latter half of this week and this weekend. And we'll look at turning off auto AI for the hunter unit. So we'll be able to use the hunter as a military unit in the early stages of gameplay. And he won't run off and go back to work, which is a good thing. We'll then move on to train up some of the arbalists or crossbowmen, and we'll take them for a spin. They are a little bit overpowered at the moment, but they are good fun. And then we will also take a look at the Swamp Ruins kit. So you saw the Swamp Swamp Environment kit in last week's Hangout. This week we've obviously extended that, and we're able to bring you some temples and walls and some cool looking things which we'll take you through. What we're looking at here, we're also looking at a slightly modified grass system. The grass is now tinted based on what is on the terrain underneath it. So it wasn't so much of an issue for the grasslands because it was all pretty much green. But in the swamp, we've got quite a few other variations of texture, and we needed to support general grass. So that is now all automated. Nothing you guys need to do in the editor. It's all taken care of. So the first thing we're going to do, we've also changed a couple of the training icons as well, but first thing I need to do is get started with the settlement. So I'm just going to sort of zoom through that process. Let's get put down a few cottages. So at the moment we have no capacity, so by building a cottage we're able to add 5 peasants to our village. So I've just built
building
2, so we should
completed.
Have. So we just have 10. Just let me check. I've turned the volume down. Yeah, that's fine. Oops. Okay. And then the first thing we want is we probably want to build a hunting lodge.
New villagers have arrived. Building completed.
And it's gone to night time. And while we're doing that, I'll just move over here.
New villagers have arrived.
And I will construct our
building completed.
Can that go? Let's see. Can we squeeze it in there? Yes, we can. So we'll put a stonecutter's lodge in there because we've got our new stone, rocks, and stuff.
New
now, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to pull up the console. Doing Control Shift X. This will be shipping in 0.2.10. I'm just going to type in day
completed.
Into that, and it's going to force it into daytime because it's kind of dark. Likewise, I can also bring it up. I could type night if I want, and we can just flick back. So sorry for just killing the immersion there.
Have arrived.
But that's something that's going to help the those among you that design maps in the editor, and you want to play test them. We'll be releasing a page on the website about that and all the commands that are supported, but that should be very useful for spawning units and killing things off and healing units and whatever. All right,
my love.
So we've changed the way that training happens ever so slightly, and instead of being a generic sort of train icon, we now have specific icons for each profession. And the reason that we've done this is I will show you on the barracks, because you can train multiple professions at the barracks. Boofles, if it's freezing for you, that's Twitch. It's not us. Generally, we've got no problem. Twitch is known to have problems in different countries at different times, so sorry about that. You can always watch the stream after, because we usually post it to our YouTube channel. There's a whole playlist in there the dev hangout so that you can watch them, and that will be smooth as anything. Anyway, I digress. So he's going to crack on with that. What I really wanted to show you was the hunters. So here he's got little bow.
New villagers have arrived.
Okay, so we now have the hunter.
New villagers
and if I leave
have arrived.
Him,
how can I help?
Actually, let me think. Is it turned off by default? All right. Okay. So it must be turned off by default. So I'll check that. That must be a mistake. So as you guys are no doubt aware, the hunter would be quite difficult to actually use them as a military unit because they would just want to go out hunting and presume their professions. Now, although the UI is not showing it, we can actually turn off auto AI. And then what that does is he should then do as he's told and stand still. And it means that we can actually use him as a military unit. So I don't know if you remember all the way back to the tutorial and there was the monk and the monks always used to run off. Well, we designed the UI so that you were able to turn that off. And I'll go and I'm going to take out a swamp beast anyway, which is a pretty... In fact, before I do, I'll just come back here. He's just taken out a deer. You see, he's not going to collect it. So normally he'd kill the deer and then it'd come back. Now, what I wanted to actually do, I'm going to use the console again. Type one of everything in there. And that's actually going to give me one of every item. So I just need to close that down and then open the global inventory again. And let's give him some gear. Now, being a hunter, I think, should we let him, let's give him cloth gear. So you'll see that his armor rating is going up. Pile on. And one thing I'll be doing this week is I'll be setting up all of the values for all of the existing gear that we've got and all of the new gear that we'll be adding in to this patch. So at the moment, a lot of the items don't do things. It's firing, so it's like the swamp beast. Yeah. Let's just swap to daytime to see this. Okay. So he's actually taking
something
out that. Now this guy would just get one shot killed. Although with armor at the moment, it's a bit overpowered. So because he's slow moving, I'm just going to actually control the guy and just take pot shots at him. Down, see what he's actually doing. Oh, she actually, it's a female unit, sorry. And I don't want to get too close. I should really have trained two, shouldn't I? In fact, let's just go back here. And by the time I've trained two,
yep.
You go in there. And I think auto AI is turned off by default, so we'll leave that on for now. Oh no, he's going to get his health back.
That's new villagers have arrived.
Oh, two guys, it'll be a lot quicker.
Yes, Petal.
Some of the additions to the swamp kit that we've added this week. So we've added in new mushrooms. You still have access to the red mushrooms that were in the grasslands. Yeah, this should go a lot quicker. There we go. Right, so we've taken them out. Okay, so that's hunters anyway, so let's just
yes,
they can go back to hunting. What I wanted to show you, let's go ahead and just build up some more resources, because I think we're going to be playing this for a while, so let's see, I need the blacksmiths, build that. I should probably let me go and grab somebody because I'm not. This
what now?
All right, dear.
My pleasure. On my way. Ta-ta. Really? Okay.
Right okay. away.
Now let's try. Alright, this is why you need to play test your maps, because you need to make sure that there's enough room to build the required buildings nearby. There we go, bonk that there. Okay. So let's think. We've got hunting sorted out, we've got the stonecutters sorted out. Oh, woodcutters. Yep, might help if we get those guys up. So we need to find. Yep, I can see
building
some there.
Completed.
Let's plonk it there. That looks like a pretty good place. Train some woodcutters. So Melchia is asking, are skirmish mode something you've been thinking about? I think we're going to make a decision on skirmish mode. Once we've reached a certain stage. So at the moment we are obviously working on the swamp kit assets. A part of that, which is in production at the moment, are the goblin buildings, and then that could be extended to add the AI that could maybe support skirmish mode. So it's something that we'll probably consider later on. I'm getting that screen stagger for some reason. Why is that? It's turning on often. Okay, don't know why. Okay, so we want to get arbalists, don't we? So let's go ahead and get our barracks. Boofalls is asking, is there going to be any sort of multiplayer modes? No. Is the answer to that. Folktale always has been and always will be a single player game. Goose McDucks is asking, will those the stones for boundaries on buildings soon be gone? I don't know if it was you that was mentioned in the forum, but somebody asked a question about that and saying that it was messing up their village. They're required, when you place a building, just to show where the boundary, where a building is to be constructed, which helps when you're planning. Do we need them once your building's constructed? We may choose to remove them. I mean, I personally like them, so I guess it depends how many people like them or hate them. Okay, so
something to do.
I mentioned that we changed the way training was done ever so slightly. So here we can train the City Watch. Or we can train. Oh, it says crossbowman at the moment. We need to change that to the new name of arbalist. So we will chain all four of those, and then I will just drop down. So these are arbalists, massively overpowered. So let's go and take them to explore the map.
New villagers have arrived.
So let's go. Let's see, let's go up here. I'm just going to swap it back to daytime because I think it probably looks a bit better in the stream.
New villagers have arrived.
Ord is asking, will there be new building animations for the next patch? I'm trying to think if there are any. They've obviously been worked on, but we've not implemented them yet. So possibly not. Right, here we go, so they're all. Let's get down.
New villagers have arrived.
Run, 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 run. They've got no armor on these guys, so. Okay. I need to be a little bit more careful. So you'll see that reload is quite slow. They did quite a lot of damage. some loot. So I should probably actually give these guys some armor, so let's do that now. Chain. Give this guy... I don't think much of the goblin stuff. I know. A lot of the goblin stuff hasn't been set up with attributes yet. You'll also see that we've added in resistances as well. Let's see, this guy's got a crossbow. I'm not sure the crossbows have been set up to provide different levels of damage at the moment. That's happening this week. Otherwise, I could equip a better crossbow and these guys would do more damage. Yeah, Arbalest will be a fairly expensive unit to train. They're sort of like a mid-stage unit in the gameplay. You won't initially have access to them. So you'll start off really quite simple, and maybe use your hunters with their bows for ranged units. And then as you progress and unlock more. Hey Owen, thanks for joining us in Hangout. Yeah, as you progress more, you'll unlock what you need, research and things like that. I don't think I gave this guy any, did I? No, I don't. Plates, number plate is set up. So let's just add one and everything again. Oops. I'm giving it some cloth because I know cloth works. So at the moment I'm dragging. The reason why we haven't put in right click yet is an engine bug. It's now been fixed, but other bugs that have been introduced in the engine are preventing us from upgrading to that. So we're just holding off. Normally it's 2 to 3 weeks in between engine patches. So we should be able to enable right-click soon. So rather than having to drag the inventory item each time, I'll just be able to right-click on it. Okay. So now they've got some armor. They should... I think in this build they're pretty much invincible. Let's turn back to daytime. Let's go in. As I said, they're pretty hardcore, these guys. So really what you want to do is you want to take some City Watch around with you so that the City Watch engage in melee and these guys can stand back and just sort of pop off their bolts. Goose McDucks is asking, will enemies sometimes dodge incoming arrows and bolts? It might be something that we implement, so a chance to dodge. There is actually in the character sheet a stat which is your percentage chance of evading. And that applies to all characters, not just humans. So it may be that we put in dodging. As a reaction animation. It just means that every monster that has a chance to dodge will need that dodging animation. So it is something we're considering. It's not in at the moment. Okay, and Stone would ask the same question. Deputy Dan KKK is asking, is there going to be a campaign, maybe with tutorial implemented, or is it solely a city building sandbox now? There will be campaign-like questing in it. So the tutorial was very heavily campaign. We've designed a system called the Encounter System that it's not implemented yet, but that will enable much of the sort of storyline and questing that's in the tutorial. Before we can implement that, we need to sort of build all the world, and eventually we'll actually migrate the tutorial across to Sandbox. So you'll notice that we've done the Grasslands, which is the setting for your human village when you first started the tutorial, and eventually you end up in the swamp, which is what this environment is. And the environments are fairly quick to roll out. Now we've got all the systems worked out for all the tiles and everything. We can fairly quickly roll these out. And once we've got all of the biomes done that we need for the tutorial, then we'll look to start bringing that across. Because by that time, quite a lot of the mechanics will be in the game. Just swap into daytime again. chest. Go and pick that up. Okay, so we've got some... it's Kobold Camp. Okay, so let's have a look at some of the... actually, let's go to the back. Oh, where did they go? Oh, I'll show you a repeat spawner. Yeah, they're pretty much invulnerable. That little flicker's a bug that we know about. So over here, we've got a repeat spawn zone. I think I've said it. I can show you in the editor later. Stonewood is asking, will there be an auto-equip button for the inventory, or perhaps a global setting for immediate equipping when picking up items? Okay, so I think I briefly discussed this in the last Hangout. We're going to change the way inventory works slightly, in that buildings will have like a local inventory store, like a gear store. So as you're adventuring around and finding loot, it will go into your global inventory, but what you really want to do, you don't want to get caught in the micromanagement, because you saw what I was doing with the military units. I was sort of clicking here and going, all right, dragging all this and everything. And that's fine probably for your heroes, but you might not want to get down into that sort of detail for your woodcutters, your stonecutters and things like that. And obviously they've got tools and their own weapons. So what we're going to do, we were discussing this a couple of weeks ago. I'm going to go and find... like the Stonecutter's Lodge. So in the Stonecutter's Lodge, there will, under the building dialogue, there will be a tab to access this local store. And then what you will do is you will you'll just drag items that you want to make available to the Stonecutters in that building, and then they will just automatically swap out the best gear and do that. So as you drop in new gear, if it's better than what they've got, it will just automatically equip and they'll swap out gear like that. So you don't have to go through and equipping each individual character. So, you know, you might be crafting new gear, or you might be, you know, looting it off corpses or in chests. All right, there is a repeat spawn about there, but I guess the kobolds are wandering around the map. Oh, here's a wanderer. Orward saying that we mentioned that a party of four will be able to cross portals like in RPGs. What about armies? It's really yet to be confirmed, but at the moment the plan is just your adventuring party. We do have a design goal to think about, which is, well, what about, do you want to sort of lay siege to like the goblin camp? So it's that... requires a little bit more design, but at the moment we're just saying it's the adventuring party. Right, so some of the other props, we've got sort of trees with I can't remember what it's called actually. It's one of like the most common plants, trees in swamps. I just can't remember what it's called. So there's that in there. So lots of different trees. We've got, I think, six different bushes. This is just in the swamp kit. The Swamp Ruins kit is completely different. So let's just jump into daytime again. Walkways are all working, so I can just sort of zoom out, go back to my village, and I'll click there. And these are all snapped together now, so you can easily construct these sort of platforms. Yes, that's exactly what happens. Basically, you dump the gear into the building, and the guys who work in the building take care of it and auto-equip the best stuff. Okay, so the next thing that I wanted to show is if I... Let's get our arbalists and take them up there. I think for this, actually, I'm just going to send them up... there, and then I'm going to walk up there. Because that's where I have used the Swamp Ruins kit. I don't think there are any monsters up there, and they'll be able to take care of themselves. Alright, so we're going to drop down into first person. And this is our first swamp temple. Oh yeah! we've got walls, so all of these walls are built out. Let's just set them up there. Some are all merged together, but actually these walls are all constructed from individual pieces. So it's got the walls and the trim and the bits on the top and the flowers and the crumbled bits and things like that. So let's just zoom up and get a better idea of where we're at. So let's get one guy, send him over there, and get another one, send him over here. All right, and you'll be able to. There's lots and lots of pieces in this kit. Actually, let's go around the side. So this is like a straight up stairs, but you can do sort of other things. I think there are six different types of stair. So we've got this. I like kind of going all the way up to the top and say, right, go up there. I was watching them climb the stairs. and I was sort of messing around with the pieces, right? And I thought, okay, then this is actually going to be where the good race is going to be that we haven't revealed yet. The characters have just been worked on at the moment, so this is going to be revealed really soon, possibly in the next dev blog. Just catching up on chat. Right, so anyway, as I was saying, all of these pieces are all individual pieces, and I thought, well, how far can we take this? So I thought, oh, well, let's go inside. And let's bring our guys as well. So let's walk down the stairs. And you know what? I want my guys to come with me. So let's get them in there as well. Send them down there. I mean, it's not intended to be used like this, but if I wanted to do it. So knowing you guys, I'm really interested to see what you're going to do with this. We are, I'll show you. It definitely wasn't designed for this, you know. We don't have ceilings for a start at the moment, but we're going to put those in. I was discussing this morning with Half Voxel, and, you know, we're going to put those pieces in so that you can play around with that and see what you come up with. There are some caveats, like when it goes dark, it goes dark inside as well, which is in a sealed room that makes no sense at all. But yeah, I don't know. It's something to play around with. There you go. It's gone to nighttime now. It's something to play around with. Let's see where it goes. It's not something that's planned or intended, but yeah, let's experiment. So let's get out of here. We'll leave the guys down there. We've got to put colliders and all sorts of things in there just to clean it up. So they're down in the deep, so let's just tell them, right, come on, let's get you out. So they're running up the stairs. That's it, and then they're out of the door. So as I say, we've got to put camera colliders on. I love standing up the top here and looking down. So what we'll do is we will jump into the editor and have a look at some of these pieces. Actually, another thing that we've fixed is, I don't know if you remember, but we've seen a fair amount of flicker on roads, the decals that we use for roads. We have fixed that in this patch, so now roads don't flicker at all, just sort of zooming all the way. So that's quite nice. Okay. So what we'll do is we will... just let me answer this. So traffic's asking, how come the chart with expected completion and patches disappeared off the Steam page? I don't think it would have... Well, it most certainly didn't say the expected completion, but the patches should be on there. I think if you just have to make sure you click the expand to scroll down the bottom. But it is on there because it gets updated every patch. Yeah, definitely on there. I think it's purple. I think. Anywho's. Right, so I'm still working on this. I mean, if I zoom out, you'll see that I'm still working on this map. So Tyre Karaman is asking, could you please talk about the enemy spawning again? Is there a way to influence that in the game? Goosemith's just saying about texture flicker on. Yeah, that's the decals. I just need to manually adjust those, the depth of those, because path is slightly different. So when each piece of geometry that forms the path is created, we ever so slightly in code adjust the height so that no pieces of geometry exist on the same plane. Now I've manually placed these decals and they're all on the same plane, so that's why we're getting flicker on that. So we just, all I need to do, which I will do in the editor, is I'll grab a piece of the decal and I'll just move it ever so slightly forward, and that'll stop the flicker that you're seeing there. Right, so just bear with me a second and I will jump into the editor. Philo Quark's asking, is there a status for save games and sandbox mode? Well, this is sandbox that we're looking at now. There's a topic in the forum which says the official, is sandbox available? Something like that. You'd have to look at it. It's not officially available until patch 0.3 is released, which will be a comprehensive, playable experience. So that's why we're saying that sandbox isn't officially available. Well, clearly it is, because that's what we're showing off. Now then, I want to pull in the runes kit. There are no curse. Oops, just lower the frame rate. There are no icons at the moment, so that's another task for this week. You always do it literally on patch week. That's a lot of icons to produce. That is two kits with a lot of pieces in it, so not particularly looking forward to that job. So you wanted me to go into the spawning. All right, so you can see here that we've got a number of spawn points. Let's hide my camera so you guys can see. Hey, I remembered that time. I don't usually remember to hide the camera. So let's get rid of that because it's irrelevant. Okay. What in particular do you want me to run through? How you set them up, or... see if you can type while you're typing that. I'll answer some of the questions. Goosebumps also saying, so... I'm not sure. I don't follow. I was mentioning about these decals. We call it Z fighting because on a 3D axis X, Y, and Z, Z is depth and the distance from camera usually. And we call it Z fighting when two pieces of geometry are basically fighting. They're at the same level and they're fighting for which one gets rendered first. So you'll see there is a little twitch. So all I need to do, I can do this a number of ways actually. For placing these, because they're on a sloped wall, I find it's actually quite useful to swap to the local coordinate system. And then all I need to do is just bring that forward a little bit. And basically anywhere that I saw, make sure you've got the right thing selected. anywhere that you saw flicker, you just need to, just ever so slightly, just tweak it out a little bit. There's obviously something going on here, so let's try and do that. I hope this works. This should be what it is. What's going on there? Okay. What's going on there? Oh, maybe not this piece, actually, it might be the other pieces. Let's see if we can fix that. I'm not doing very good at fixing this, am I? Okay, I'll talk to R-Fox and we'll figure that out, and hopefully we can talk about that in next week's Hangout. Ord is asking, will the fixed camera movement be back anytime soon? Yes, it will, because the frame rate varies massively. So if I, for example, was to go all the way over here and then drop down and turn around, if I do that, even with all the optimizations in, there's a... Well, actually, let's just raise up the camera. If I go up here, now this is a fast machine, but that's an awful lot of geometry to render. And not all computers are going to be fast enough for that. So what we're going to do, as I've said before, so we're going to fix the angle in more of a conventional RTS. Fix the camera angle in a more conventional RTS overhead view. You'll still be able to change the angle by holding down the Alt key and moving the mouse pointer. And then under settings, there will be an option to turn it off altogether. So if you have got a good gaming PC, and you happen to like free look camera, then you will be able to do that. But we have to think about performance on more of a typical gaming PC. Okay, let's get onto these spawn things. Okay, so Tara Crumb is asking, will the amount of spawning enemies somehow adjust to the size of the village, like more enemies once you've got your defences up, or is that fixed? At the moment, there isn't an adjustment for that. Obviously, there is going to have to be something like that, which we will evolve the spawn system into something that addresses that. But at the moment, there's no support in for that. Just reading the chat. There are no triggers on the at the moment in the game. Again, that's something that will be coming once we've got like an event system in there for spawning, say, cinematics or ambushes or things like that. It's really up to the map designer in terms of whether they will attack your village or not. So one of the behaviours that you can set for a wave is you can tell them to seek out the player, and that will go and they'll go and find the nearest characters or monsters. So in a sort of tower defence style game, you would set that to always seek out player, and you would also have let's go to this, not that one, let's jump over to this guy. So because this one is set to repeat, you have to set up repeats in a slightly different way. So you basically have a wave that doesn't spawn anything, so there's no group added, but you, I just say time since start. I should probably make that time since last wave, thinking about it. 30 seconds, doesn't spawn anything, but then the next one just says spawned alive less than or equal to. Right, so that's when they're all dead. Yeah, so when they're all dead, I've set it to spawn a group of 5 kobolds. So 5 will spawn, and then it'll wait 30 seconds until it does the test for it, I think. Half-Fox is probably better at describing this than me. And then if I've basically killed off all of the kobolds, then it'll spawn another 5. All right, so there is a way to... I need to add this into the editor guide in terms of how you set up spawning, spawn loops. But there's no limit on the number of waves that you can add, so you can just keep on adding wave after wave and make them progressively stronger. So let's get rid of that one. But if I go into here, one of the fields is the health multiplier. So if I want them to get progressively tougher and give them more health, for now I can just, you know, I could say put in two, and that would be like they'd have double the health. 0.5 would be half the health. That would be, you know, a load more. Okay, reading. Okay, anyway, let's look at the swamp pieces, because that's really what a lot of folks will be interested in. So the first thing, let's look at, let's see, this piece of wall here. So it's made up of a lot of different parts. I think what we can do is we can bring me back. It's made up of a lot of different parts, so I can pull out the trim, and then we've got sort of like a rubble. You'll see that the title up here is Rubble Half 02. And then we've got some little raised steps. And we've got a wall. And all of this gets combined together when the game, when you're in player, to keep performance up. So let's just undo all of that using Control Z. Okay. What I tend to do is I tend to select all of the pieces that are in that. I freeze the terrain first. So I just select all of the pieces. And then I group them together. Sorry, I haven't done a particularly good job of that. But I group them together, and then, yeah, you see all these pieces, and I've got a tile, and yeah. And then I can move them around. Now, one thing that the regular community map makers will know about, and it's one thing that we most definitely feel in development when we're making maps, is that your groups don't save. So if I come into a design session, I set up all my groups, I save the map, and then if I load, I quit and then come back tomorrow, I load in the map, all of those groups are gone, which is quite frustrating, especially when you're working on large complex pieces. So what we'll be doing is we'll be either saving your groups in the map as sort of like a short-term implementation, so that when you load in the map again, it will remember all of the previous groups, so they will be set up, and that makes it much, much quicker for editing maps over multiple sessions. Now, that is only sort of like as a temporary fix, because what we really want to do is have like a prefabs library system. So what I could do is I could come down here, I could select all these individual bits. Yeah, prefabs, templates, whatever you call them. We call them prefabs. So you could choose all these pieces, and then you'll go up to the prefab menu, save it as a prefab, give it a name, and then it would be saved, and you could use that on any map that you were designing. So not just this map, but if I wanted to create a second swamp map, then I would have access to that prefab. I'd also like to integrate it with the community share services so that you could actually upload some of your prefabs, so some of the more advanced map designers make some really cool stuff, and they could actually share those with the community, and you could download those and use those sort of props yourself, which is a really cool idea. So these are all things that we're discussing and that we definitely want to be looking to implement. But for now, we'll probably do, you know, a sort of like a quick fix and save groups within the same map, and introduce a prefabs template library sort of thing in a future release. That is going to be most likely after patch 0.3, but I would imagine it's probably going to be in the 0.3.x release cycle. Okay, time for me to come chat, have a quick drink, excuse me. Goose McDucks is asking about, is there a way to add more monsters or health in each repeat? I can't answer too many questions at this point because there is obviously a need for scaling up the threat. We haven't designed one and implemented it yet. When we sit down and figure out what can be supported, then I'll discuss it in the Hangout and we can get some feedback on that. But I can't answer questions until we've actually sat down and had that design session. Ty Crime is asking how long would it take, like, a regular player to design a map of this size? At the moment, a fair amount of time, because there are very obvious productivity tools that we want to add in that aren't in there at the moment. So at the moment, you have to manually place all the tiles. Ideally, we would be able to paint levels of terrain in. So I could set like the height and I could just paint in this level here. You'll see that then this level is up a quarter of a tile height. So I could then paint in that height and then just literally very quickly paint in. And that would it would decrease the time it takes to create a map by quite a lot. The persisting of groups or the prefabs library, again, would help quite a lot. I would say there's a steep learning curve at the moment with the terrain tiles. That seems to be the big sticking point for a lot of players at the moment who are designing the maps, is just figuring out which pieces connect to which other ones, you know. So, and once you've got that knowledge, it becomes a lot easier. So I know that this concave piece, and there's also a convex piece, so the outside is the convex piece. And I know that, you know, we have straight pieces, and I know that we have dips. So it's really about just investing the time in learning what pieces are available, what you can achieve visually, and what are the constraints that you'll come across. The reason why we're providing maps, as many maps as we can, is so that you can go in and have a look at other maps and see how we've done things. At least there is a productivity tool, which is the terrain painting. So that's fairly quick. So let me think about this. I've locked it and I've got... Actually, it's not green that I want on that one there. All right, so it is actually fairly quick to paint terrain. So that won't slow you down. And the roads are pretty easy. You don't have to... sit in there and design every single road. There's actually a whole path system in there. You obviously have to build on places that would allow paths, so as I said, you can get quite complex but easier curves. So there you go, the little winding path. 2 seconds. So some things are really quick, other things aren't so quick. We know about them, we know ways to make them quicker. It's just a matter of priorities at the moment. It will get quicker. In terms of to create a map like this, it really depends whether you have familiarized yourself with the kit pieces or not. If you're starting from like no knowledge, I think to create something like this, it's going to take you a fair few sessions over a couple of weeks. I would say if you know, maybe 2 to 4 weeks. For someone, I've probably worked on this for, let's say 20 hours, I think, something like that. Okay, catching on with chat again. The pools behind where the village was. Do you mean these things? Or do you mean these little pools here? Oh, I should just mention, so at the moment, all of the lighting, all of the fog and everything is used in the Grasslands kit. So we'll be implementing the ambient system at some point soon, so that if you're creating a swamp map, it will look like a swamp biome. It'll have different lighting and everything. So at the moment, this is just using the same lighting as the Grassland kit, but that will change. Excuse me. Boofles is asking, is there an undo redo? Yes, there is. I can just show you that so quickly. So, wait, excuse me. If I grab a tile, I'll just move it up. I don't know, move it up. If I hold down Control X, I can step back through the undo. There isn't a redo, though, I don't think. I don't think there is, anyway. Let me try that. No. Or is it Control Shift? No, I'm not sure. I don't think there is. Maybe Half Fox can chip in, but I don't think I've ever needed a redo. Ever. In the map editor. Orwood saying, so we'll be able to raise terrain to make valleys and such with painting. I'm not saying definitely. I'm saying we'd obviously like to put that in. We've got a lot of maps to create to deliver an entire world. You know, we've got a lot of biomes. We've got a lot of maps to create. It's no good if it's going to take me 40 hours to create a map. We need to bring that time down significantly. So there is a very strong commercial argument to get those productivity tools in there. Yes, if we deliver those tools, then you would be able to paint in hills and valleys. But I'm being non-committal at this stage. Tyacram is asking, will there be biome-specific decals on the village buildings, like growing moss or hanging vines or something like that? I don't think there will be decals as such. Actually, the buildings look pretty good, being both the grasslands and the swamp. And the test will come when we get to, say, lava or snow. And it may be that for snow, we swap out the buildings' textures, because everything for the buildings, the human buildings, is on a number of atlases, which is basically all of the different texture maps are just packed into one huge image. And it's possible that we could load in an alternative image to that, that maybe had like snow on it, so you could get snow on roofs and things like that. So rather than it being decals, well, it could be decals, I suppose. It's a bridge we're going to cross when we get to it, and that's most likely going to be the lava or the snow kit. Yeah, so these are tiles with puddles. They block construction at the moment. But I think one thing I'm going to suggest, I'm going to ask the programming team, if we can actually replace a water tile. If you are going to build up, no, that's probably fine. If we can place a water tile, I'm just wondering about the static batching of the terrain. I don't know. I'm going to see if we can construct on that anyway. What about map sizes? So at the moment they are fixed, so you can see, I don't know if you can see, it's probably better if I do that. You'll see that we've got the thick sort of light blue line. Clearly that's it's not really a good constraint, so we'll be removing that constraint and you'll be able to create maps of different sizes. So if you want to start small, maybe do a little dungeon, for example, if you wanted to, I've gone ahead and created the interior of this, but really what we should be doing is we should be putting a portal in this doorway and then linking to a dungeon kit and an entirely new map that is a dungeon of the interior. excuse me. I'm not sure you would want a dungeon this size. I mean, you could. There would be nothing to stop you. I mean, in terms of the height, you've Let's see, it goes. You've got quite a good amount of depth that you could go to, so you could put in a cavernous area or something. But chances are you probably want to create, let's say it's just a little sewer or something. It might be much smaller, so you might want to create, I think this one's 50 by 50, you might want to create a 10 by 10, something like that. But that will come in time. But there's nothing to stop with you sort of experimenting and learning on, just in a smaller area. I think a mistake that a lot of people make when they first come to the editor is that they learn how the terrain fits together, and then they proceed with actually painting the entire terrain, and that can actually be a little bit demotivating, because it takes quite a long time and it won't really look that great. So what I suggest you do is you work on a much smaller area and then get that looking how you want it, and then move on to another area and think about how you want your sort of adventure to develop. And so your adventuring party arrive on the map, what's the experience going to be, what are they going to move on to, and what's the next challenge going to be, and design your map in that way. Goose McDuck is asking, will portals be only within an object, or is it something you can freely place in other objects or doors? Well, secret portal. To be decided. I mean, I can't see anything that would prevent us from just providing the raw portal. So we'll see how that goes. But I think it would make sense to provide some portals. Another thing that we've actually just discussed and we'll probably be doing real soon is that we will be having a kit specifically for putting in Navmesh cuts and colliders and things like that. So they're invisible pieces, but they can help with creating maps. Just a quick time check. Okay, we're good. So if I there are no camera colliders on this at the moment, so you can sort of see how the level's made up. I'll just maybe use some of these pieces. There's a couple of optimizations that we've still got to do, but let's say I actually want those to be down there. I can group those, duplicate them with Control D. I think so. Once you've spent some time with the editor and you know, it just pop onto the community content topic in the forum, you'll see that there are a growing number of community players that have invested that time to learn what kit pieces to go together, and it's very quick once you know that to actually be able to mock together levels. So here, for example, let's just rotate. We don't want whole wall sections there, do we? We want a half. And rather than going into the kit, I think I'll just go and grab. There we go, there's one there, so I'll grab that one. Slot that into place. Let's come down. And now, really, to be optimal, I should go and get a small. Let's see, which one is it? That's it. I should get the little. Oh no, that's the stairs. There is a piece somewhere. I know there is. The question is, where is it? Where are you? There's a one by one piece somewhere. This is where it's going to be quicker to have gone into the kit. But without the icons, it might take me a while to get. Oh, okay, never mind. So there is a piece that's that size. I'd have to find it, but for the sake of brevity, I'll just duplicate this fella. Group those, rotate them round. We do have two pieces for this, so obviously this isn't lining up at the moment. There are pieces in the kit that you can use. I'll quickly. I can see some questions being asked in Hangout. Actually, let's make a tunnel. So let's get rid of those. Grab one of these walls. Move that down. Just check that that's not sticking out of the floor, which it's not. Okay. And then let's grab this wall here. Group those together. Control D to duplicate them. Square brackets to rotate. And then I can use the cursor keys to position. And then this gate, and then Control U to ungroup. Holding down the shift key, selecting multiple walls. Control D to duplicate them. W to go into transform move mode. And then just, yeah, it's really quick. Once you've overcome that initial sort of learning curve, it's really quick to use. And then, you know, I've got all of this interior space that I could go at. It's crazy. We just need ceiling pieces in. Yeah, this is the route that they would take. So, yeah. Anywho's. Let me catch up with chat. Rogue Rocks is... sorry, just bear with me. Rogue Rocks is asking, regarding enemy AI, do they use any type of threat assessment, i.e. target is easy, so they should attack it, target is medium threat, cautious attack, target is tough, run away. Excuse me. And in the tutorial we implemented something, let me get this right. It went for the unit with the highest armor, which was presumably your tank unit. But it would also do a proximity check. So the AI that's going to be in Sandbox will be a lot smarter than what it was in the tutorial. And once we've once we know exactly how that's going to work, then we'll share that with you in Hangout. Yeah, but we obviously want monsters to be... well, we want them to act accordingly, so we want sort of like your dumb monsters to maybe just charge in there and attack the nearest unit. You may want your necromancer, who is like maybe a highly intelligent enemy, to use the minions for melee, and then they'll do some debuffing and some fear and things like that. So I think there are going to be different behavioral profiles that we will then assign to monsters. Whether we sort of fix that or whether we allow that to be set in the editor, I don't know yet. But there are, I imagine there will be a number of different types of behavioral brain that you could attach. Sorry, just catching up in chat. Goosemix Duck is asking, will there be a dungeon camera for better movement through the dungeon? Yes, there will. Is the in-game camera blocked by walls, or does it go through them? Some pieces do have colliders on it, but others don't. So, because it's a new kit, the final part of the final part of configuration is to put in the camera colliders, and the nav mesh is actually built in, but the camera cloud. So at the moment, actually, this is the editor, so I should go through anyway. But in the player at the moment, I could do this, but in like a week's time I won't be able to do that. So there you can see I can't go through the floor because that's got a camera collider on it. It's just that they haven't been added yet. So the dev hangouts are very much sort of like sharing the latest build that's in development at the moment. So quite often there might be things that are broken, or there might be missing icons or stuff like that. Well, you can see there's loads of missing icons here. So it's more of an indication as what's in the pipeline, what's about to arrive in the next patch. Just going back to the AI, yeah, some of the other things that they need to consider is threat assessment. You know, is this unit too tough for me? So it needs to look at, you know, how much damage they would do, what their armor rating is, maybe what their resistances are. Stone was asking who develops the AI at Games Foundry. That is Halfvoxel. Well, yeah, in terms of actually programming, yeah. New Pots asking, any plans for having a ruler stroke king as a character on the map? It comes up fairly frequently, that question. I'm inclined to say I don't think there's a need for it, but I think once we get more and more gameplay in there, it may be that there is a need for a character like that. We do have heroes as a completely separate class of characters, which are much more RPG style. And if you've got those, then do you really need a king, and what role would they be? Because I would be inclined to think that a player might like to take that character and use it as more of an avatar, and that's not really how the game is set up. You know, this is about a lot of people, not about one individual person in a game. But we will see. The development is very much an iterative process. You know, we have a plan, and we review that plan as we reach various development milestones and say, right, is this plan still relevant? Is it working? Does it feel right in the game now that we've put it in? If not, do we need to change it? What's community feedback? Do we need to look at that? Have they suggested something that's better? Should we try that? So it is very much, so if you imagine the start point, end point, and then that's your traditional sort of line. But because it's early access and the community is very heavily involved in feedback of that, and whether we can implement things and the community goes, rah, no, that stinks, in which case we take that feedback on board and say, they're still wrong, or, oh, they're absolutely right. You know, so we make slight deviations in that plan. The destination is ultimately the same. It's just that the way that we implement, unit selection, that may change slightly and take us slightly off what we thought was the plan. But overall, you know, it's moving in the forward direction to arrive at the final goal. Hopefully that makes sense. Ord's asking, can we expect patch 0.2.10 for the end of October or even earlier? It will be, let me think, let me have a quick look at the calendar. Okay, so it could be next weekend or it could be the weekend after that, but definitely before the end of the month. We try to keep it on, you know, sort of like an every 4 to 5 weeks schedule. And I try to make it fall so that nowadays that I can produce the blog and highlight all of this, because the hangouts are great, but there's only sort of like it's a dedicated following of the community that tend to join us in these and watch the dev hangouts. There is a much larger audience that watch the dev blogs, so we need to sort of go over everything that's been implemented, and that's what the dev blogs are for. And we've finally brought those into sync now, so we'd like to do a dev blog and a release at the same time, so players can get a very quick understanding of what's changed and what's new in there. Streamerverse asking, what exactly is the governmental and economic structure of the folktale people? I don't think we need to talk about governmental, because there's not really as any as such. There's law enforcement, and that's what the city watch is for, and there will be like punishment and things like that, and we're considering like a magistrate magistrate's building and a magistrate, maybe for like a prison and punishment and things like that. But that's about, I mean, you ultimately as the player are the ruler, and all of your units are equal. They may do different jobs, but they're all equal. It's socialist, I suppose. I said that with tongue in cheek. Economic structure. The economy chains are... You can probably check those out on the website if you look at the different buildings. So you've got things like wheat fields to grow wheat. They go to the windmill for grinding into milling into flour. The flour goes to the storehouse and then goes to the bakers who makes bread. Excuse me, that's an example of one chain. Another chain is gunpowder. That's a little bit more complicated, requiring more ingredients. And there'll be quite a few economy chains in the game. Move on to another question. Stone one's asking, what are the faces on the temple? Are they frogs, lizards, spoilers? Could be. Could be. I think we'll probably reveal all next weekend. Actually, they're really like rough paint jobs at the moment. this week, one of the texture artists will be painting in the higher resolution version of those. New part, yeah, about the king, saying that I was thinking you'd have to maybe protect the king from revolts or something like that. Yes, I suppose it could work. I mean, there is definitely scope for a unit like that. It's just whether we feel it's appropriate or not. So once we've got a whole village, complex village with behavioural interactions going and crime, we'll look at that and then we'll see whether there's a good scope for that, putting in a unit like that. Boofles is saying, I'd like to see the ability to behead certain mobs like troll or goblins and put their head on a spike outside your town to fear them from attacking. I think there was something like that in Stronghold, wasn't there? And I think they took it out because the vast majority, or I say not the vast majority, but the majority didn't like it. They found it a little bit over the top. I don't know. I don't think it's... Folktale's not like that gruesome. So I don't think we'll be putting that in. Tyra Crime is asking, are the resources finite? I know trees will get replanted, but what about stone ore? Sorry. I have a feeling this might be your first stream, so I will go over it again. It's just been covered before. What we're planning to do is there will be smaller... bits of stone and iron ore scattered around, which you can clear, and workers, so a woodcutter could be a stonecutter could be set to clear all of the small bits, so you could actually clear an area and then build in that area, and a blacksmith or miner could clear the iron ore out. And they'll continue to do that unless you sign them to one of the sustainable resources, which are your quarry and your iron mine. And they will be sustainable on the map. So there are two work modes, really. And that switch will automatically go on behind the scenes. So if you select a stone cutter and right-click on one of the small stones, that will swap them into clearing mode. And they will just clear the local area around where their home is. And if you right-click on the quarry, they'll then go and be assigned to the quarry and work at the quarry. Okay. I think it's Folktale Key giveaway time. So give me a second to set that up. Okay, just to show it's all nice and fair, so you, regulars will know what to do. To enter, you type exclamation mark and the word enter all together. If you're unsure, just watch what the other guys are doing. They will now enter the competition, and it's a completely random roll. And let's see who the winner is. Hopefully, if somebody does win that's won before, hopefully they will find it in their hearts to tell me to re-roll so that other people can have a chance of winning it. I mean, it might be generally that they've got friends, other friends that they want to give it to. Fair enough, you know. But it's up to you guys. So you can see what the other guys are doing now. They're entering the competition. Their names are appearing on the list. And then we'll do a random roll and somebody will be winning a redeemable key for Folktale on Steam. That is for the early access and the final version of the game. So you will be sent the key to your Twitch account. So you do need a Twitch account, and preferably followers. Well, that's not mandatory. And the key will be sent at the end of the stream, and then you just go to Steam, redeem the key, and you'll be able to play Folktale. If you've already got Folktale, it's not a problem. You've got friends or family that want a key, you can give it to them. So just to run by again, to enter, it's exclamation mark enter. I'll give it a few minutes because of the delay. I think a lot of you will already have the game, so these are sort of like most likely going to go to friends or family. Okay, so while that's doing that anyway, I'll jump back into the editor because we'll come back to that when it's draw time. I'll leave it open for maybe 5 minutes, something like that. And in the meantime, I'm going to go back inside and carry on designing. I'm just going to put in basic sort of structure for now. What do I want? I don't want a big room in here, don't I? So to enter the competition for a Steam key, it is exclamation mark enter. You'll see other people doing it. So to be in with a chance, you have to type that. Otherwise, you will not be included in the draw. Floor, but it's always useful to check. All right, has everybody entered? I think they've entered now, haven't they? Let's jump back. All right, good luck, everybody. This one. So we have 19 folks. So you ready? Last chance. I know that there's a delay on the stream. So the last 30 seconds. Rogue Rox is asking about the t-shirts. We've not done anything about them at the moment. It's the busiest week of the month because it's on a lead up to patch release, so we won't be looking at them now. Just remind me in the forum, will you? Next. In like 2 weeks' time, and then I can get on them. All right, roll time. Good luck. Here we go. And the winner is TTS937. Wow. That's a memorable name. So congrats to TTS937. Folktale Key will be coming your way at the end of the stream. Unless you tell me to re-roll. If you don't, but then you wouldn't have entered, I suppose. So, and you haven't won one before because I recognise it. So, all right. The giveaway is now finished. So I'll open. open that so I can send you a key later on. Let's get back to the game and answering questions. So let me scroll back. Oops. Goose McDuck's saying, how is the pathfinding inside the building? Test it out now. I tested it earlier. Yeah. So I don't know if you're in the stream at that point. Have any other classes been discussed at the moment for future release? So what we do is we push all of the publish all of the information on the units onto the website. I would say the majority are now finished. We've just finished off the witch unit and the crooked cauldron building. We do have a queue of quite a lot of characters and buildings to add in, so that they've basically been finished. So all of the models, the texture painting, the animations, they're all done. They're just waiting to go into production. But at the moment, the programming team are focusing on character leveling. So, you know, gaining XP, being able to spend attributes on your characters, that sort of thing. Probably in the next patch, I want to just focus exclusively on buildings and professions and get those in. But there's not much point in putting in units such as like the witch, because until crafting is enabled, because they are fundamentally a crafting profession. So it makes more sense to focus on gameplay and get that in, and then move on and get all the professions that rely on things like crafting. We're working on all the gear at the moment, so on the next step for me this week is to put in all the attributes on all the gear, and then we'll be in a good position to implement crafting. And then once crafting is enabled, then we can add in a lot of the final units. But certainly, like the weaver actually isn't a crafting one, and the tailor, well, the tailor is actually more of a crafting one, but they do also produce clothing, which is like a consumable that your villagers need. So I mean, those things could definitely go in, but it's just a matter of time, time and priorities. But if you watch certainly the dev blogs, there'll be information on all of the units that are ready for inclusion. I just need to get some posed versions of them so that I can update the website. But I would say something like 80% of the units are now done. The cavalry has been started, so that unit, the horse is already done, although it needs armor adding onto it. But the cavalry unit is in production at the moment. I need to update the roadmap actually, just to show what's in. What steps various things are at. Boofles is asking, will there be any sort of magic like wizards, witch class? Well, yeah, there are witches. They're listed in the website. It's www.gamesfoundry.com. And there is magic. Necromancers that can raise undead zombies and resurrect. Yeah, there are necromancers. They've been shared in the if you go to blog.gamesfoundry.com and just scroll through there, you will see lots of different monsters and units, and you'll get a very good idea of what's coming real soon. To camera height, that's not bad. And then I want to actually use the inspector to set that to 90 degrees, rotation on the y-axis, and just tuck it into the wall. Lovely. Job done. We're building a big big sort of room here. I suppose we are, aren't we? Have I allowed enough headroom? Yes, I have. Okay. We'll probably be adding zombies in, I think, at some time. They're a popular monster. We've got some interesting ideas for them. So yeah, I think they'll be going in soon. Not soon, just when the time comes. I think we might, I wonder if we should make them, no, I suppose they'll be undead. But it's a little bit of fun. A little bit of weekend fun. One thing that when I was doing this, one thing that I got thinking of is at the moment
let me think about this. It's the.
We'll have to go and have a look. What's it called on the wave spawners? Maximum stalk distance. I think we'll also have to have an aggro radius as well, because. What we don't want, if we're going to put monsters in somewhere like this, what we don't want is you to be on the wall here, on the stair. Oh, look at that, Mr. There we go. We don't want you to be stood on the wall here and then the monster get in aggro range and go all the way up and come down, because that'll just be sort of ruin it. So I think what we want to do is to be able to set very small aggro ranges. I have a feeling that doing that in the editor is probably the best place. To do that. Okay, I'm just oops, no, we don't want to do that. Just pressing the wrong key. I mean, one thing that is on the roadmap is the buildings interiors, which are all sorts of chairs and props and things like that. So if I actually had that, then I could probably kit this out. But I suppose it makes no sense being a. Well, we'll have to wait. We've got to introduce the good. Race in the swamp. So the evil race, both will be fairly neutral and you'll be able to befriend I say one or the other, because if you to befriend like the goblins, if you wanted to play and actually befriend the goblins, you'd have to do quests that help the goblins, and they typically would involve their arch rival, which is this other race. And that's going to reduce your faction standing with this other race. But there's nothing, you know, nothing to stop you either starting the game and saying, oh, actually, this time I'm playing, I actually want to befriend this friendly race and go and help them against the goblins. So that will be really down to you. But I suppose, given that this temple is meant to be their sort of like their habitat, that we could do with some props. One prop I saw that was really cool. In fact, let's try and do this now. I've only briefly saw it. I think it was Outlaw Albino guy that did it. And he made a really interesting sort of torch-like thing. So I'm going to try and replicate it just from memory here. So I think it uses the kobold props, I think. Maybe the wall spike, was it? What sort of height is it at? And then I think it used the undead cemetery. So is that a cemetery kit? Oh no, hang on. Let me think. Where are the bones? Are they in here? Oh, they're in here. All right, okay. And they sort of he made it like almost like it was a skeleton on a spike. So that's like it's sort of impaled. Probably need to rotate that a little bit. Let's give a skull. Actually, no, that's going to be far scarier if we use one of those. So it's a freaky ox head man skeleton thing. Let's scale that down so it's kind of more fitting. Here we go. We're creating new races here. Let's give him a hip bone. Actually, no, we probably don't need a hip bone. It's probably all right like that. Right, and then I think this is the way particles worked. You probably... Actually, let's think. So we need the grasslands kit. Excuse me. You shouldn't really combine props together like this. So I'm borrowing props out of the grasslands kit, which is just going to consume graphics card memory, and it's a no-no. And we will probably prevent that in future, but for now, and then we'll move across things like flames and things into a kit that you can use, but for now all the flames are in the grassland kit, which is down the bottom. I seem to remember grassland, yes it is. Let's get a simple torch, preferably with no has that got fire. Yes it has. All right, now if I scale this down, it will still give. And we'll do a separate particles kit. But if we just zoom that, scale that down, then we'll just get the flames. To nothing. I can't actually grab hold of the damn thing. That serves me right, doesn't it? Well, let's group together these things. Oh, it's now so small that I can't actually select it. Which is why we need a kit for it. Silly me. Oh. Not quite sure what happened there. Why is it disappearing? Alright. So, there's obviously a problem with this and doing it this way. She shouldn't really do it this way. And as I say, we'll be creating sort of common kits that you can use throughout all of the different map designs. So, campfires, flaming sconces, things like that, they'll all be moved into a common kit that'll be optimized for video. Video card memory use. I wonder if that's the LOD system kicking in or not, because now it's I don't know. Oh, anyway. I suppose I could have hidden that inside, really, shouldn't I? Let's save that out and see how that looks. Maybe do I want to add some arms or something into it? Let's have a look. Maybe some feet or something, or maybe a... So actually rotate this 180 degrees. And then I think I want to put a pile of bones on the floor. So scale that up. Rotate that round. This is a perfect example of like a what would make a great prefab. You know, I could do this, create it, pop it up on the share services, and then other players could actually, oh, look, little horns as well, and then other players could actually download it as well. What bones are these though? Oh, they were bone two, so it was bone one that I want. Stack them a little bit, and then I think maybe I want some little stones, so let's go into the swamp kit, and it'll be under bold rocks, sorry, rocks small, maybe, that's not particularly small, small rock cluster, let's scale that down a little bit, and I don't think there are grass. There's not grass props in the swamp at the moment. But what we do have is mushrooms, and I think we probably want a brown mushroom for this one. I think the orange would be, it would just look a bit too weird because it's a bit too nice. It just wouldn't, you know, just... Let's use those and scale them down. All right. Tell you what. I'll grab this fella. Make sure it's big enough for us to actually select. To select that for some reason. Oh gosh. Right, okay. It off. I want to put a foot in there. Do we have foot? Maybe we don't have feet yet. We've just got a leg bone. Oh, never mind. What else have we got in the cemetery kit since we're doing that? Little pile of mud. No. Waterfall. No. And I can't, that's a window, I can't scale like that. All right. So let's zoom back to where we start. Where do we want the camera when we start the game? About this sort of distance from our spawn point. So go to save and save over. We know there's a bug that should say save. So that's saved. I'm just going to jump across into the player. All right, Stonewood, thanks for joining us today. Enjoy the rest of your weekend. I don't know, it was
all right,
well, point pleasure.
All right, dear.
Oh, let's turn down the volume.
Right away.
Okay. Credit where it's due.
A woman's work is never done.
Outlaw,
be right there, darling.
Outlaw.
Busy.
Albino guys.
All right, dear.
Idea.
On my way.
Let's wait for my characters to arrive.
Right away. Okay.
Yes, my dear.
Let's go tonight. Let's get a better idea. Ooh, creepy. Halloween. It's a really cool sort of prop. Made up from all the little bits of extra props, so. I thought it was a really innovative use of the prop parts. It looked kind of creepy as well. So yeah, quick check on the time. I think we can probably wrap up today's hangout there. So thanks for joining us today. If you have some weekend left, then have a great Sunday. If you're in Australia, thanks for joining us on the very early hours of Monday morning. And we will see you next weekend, possibly with patch 0.2.10. All right, take care, guys.